So this shiur will be dedicated to Yilui Nishmat, my grandfather Avraham ben Mazal Tov. It is your site, and I could not pick anything better to describe what my grandfather was about from this Zohar. The Zohar says, Rabbi Yisa patach ve'amar, Rabbi Yisa said, Kama yesh la adam le'ehov et HaKadosh Baruch Hu. How much does a man need to love HaKadosh Baruch Hu, to love God? Ki en avoda lifnei HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Avodah means what? Service. Kmo ahava. The best way to serve God is through love. Love Him. Not just fear Him. The level is a completely different interaction when two people can do the same act. One does it because of fear, one does it because of love. It's completely different outcomes of the two, between the two. V'chol mi she'ohev oto, whoever loves HaKadosh Baruch Hu, ve'oseh ahava, avodah be'ahava, and he services God with love, kore lo HaKadosh Baruch Hu ahuv. HaKadosh Baruch Hu calls him my beloved one. And it is a wonderful thing. I mean, you know what? Let's just take a pause 1 second. you have people working. Let's say, for example, you're going to a restaurant or you're going to a coffee shop, and there are two people there. One is working there because he really needs to work there. He needs the money. Everybody needs the money. Nobody's working for volunteer, but you know, he needs the money. But he doesn't really like it. He thinks he's better than that. He doesn't really need to do the job. So his job is, you know, when he comes to service the people, the service is quite evident. You know, he's not going to be so nice and polite and so on and so forth. But the other person actually likes his job. You know, he says, listen, I have a terrific job. I get to see so many people. I have to have interaction with people. I love it. And he loves what he's doing. So the difference of services is the good morning that the two people will tell you could be completely different. And actually, you would like to come to the place. And so on and so forth. You go to a diner, comes this waitress, she's, you know, she looks like, hey, what do you want? We got eggs and cheese. Blah, blah, blah. Okay, I forget. I'm on a diet. I don't want to eat. Let me get out. And, good morning, sir. How are you doing today? Yeah, would you like, you know, and it's totally different. The service of, the level of service is mainly dependent on how much you love to do what you do. You could be doing the best job in the world, whatever that will be. If you don't love what you do, it will stink. It will be bad. That's why many people are not successful in life, because they don't love what they do. They think they deserve something better and this and that. Or they picked up something not based according to what they love. A person is, let's say, a genius. Genius! Tremendous IQ, he scores high on everything and so on and so forth. However, he doesn't see himself being a lawyer, doctor, slash, you know, working all day long inside, confined, filing papers. He likes to work outdoors. He likes the outdoors interaction. He likes to experiment, to do this and to do that. So, okay, so he becomes an engineer for hydroponics in desert areas. He loves it all day long. He's in mud and then... Some people would say, what a waste, what a waste. You know, he could have made so much more money. But what is the price that you're going to pay for this money? Because you don't love it. You don't love what you do. You need to love what you do. And that is also when you make a decision, you know, when you pick up your spouse. Oh, is that person going to have a lot of money? What could I get from marrying that person? And that's you making mistakes. It's a terrible mistake. You don't marry a person because their father has money, or their mother has money, or they have a good job, or they don't have a good job, or she can give me income, or he can give me income, or I can sit at home and do absolutely nothing, and so on and so forth. Do you see anything together with this person? You know, any building blocks together? Because you really know what you are. You love what you do. So you need somebody that shares the same thing. And this is how love comes into the house. So when HaKadosh Baruch Hu, when you do something me'ahava, when you serve Hashem with love, HaKadosh Baruch Hu calls you ahuv, my beloved one. I don't think that there's a greater title in the world to be called a beloved one by God. Not a doctor, not a Nobel Peace Prize, not a president of the United States, nothing. When God calls you a beloved one, that's the greatest compliment that a human can ever get in his life. Of course, in our world, it's not being determined like that. Our world is, you know, the titles that you have, rabbi, doctor, slash professor, or professor, rabbi, doctor, or whichever order of, you know, important it is for you. Oh, my name is, and I hate when people say, oh, my name is Dr. So-and-so, or Dr. So-and-so. You know, maybe your father should have called you doctor. That will be easy. You don't have to go to school. What's your name? My name is Doctor. Oh, you know, yes, I'm a doctor from birth. Wow, it's amazing. Doctor, you know. Oh, professor, you know. You know. My name is Professor Sam. Oh, Professor Sam, where do you teach? Oh, I can't tell you, you know. In the University of Life. You know, it's a, you know, you do maybe a great chesed to your child. You give him the utmost freedom. You can do, actually, if you give him a name that is a title, maybe they could finally live their life the way they want, because they don't have to get the title. They already have it. The name is Doctor. This is an ingenious idea, right? And it says, Umakshe, therefore you ask a question. Imken, therefore, Ech ifshar la'amid elu aktuvim kakatuv, right? How could we establish the psukim, or to understand the psukim, Re'acha v're'a avicha al ta'azov, v'katuv hoker aglecha mi'bet re'echa, and so on. How do we deal with all this, with all the psukim that really refers to, you know, love and companionship and so on and so forth, and removing yourself, if you do it me'ahava? It says, but we already explained the Re'acha v're'a avicha al ta'azov. Katuv be'olot u'shlamim. When it says, "Don't leave your friend or your beloved one," that refers to olot u'shlamim. Aval bechataot ve'ashamot. When we bring the korban chatat and korban asham, ne'emar hoker aglecha mi'bet re'echa. And it says, "Re'echa ve're'a avicha al ta'azov, al ta'azov la'avot odol u'idabek bo la'asot mitzvotav." When we are talking about avodat Hashem, we have to think very carefully when we live our life. How will we actually interact with our actions? That action, how does this action interact with HaKadosh Baruch Hu? If you, for example, have a wife, do you love your wife at home only, or you love her at work? Do you love your wife when you drive your car? Or you don't? When you live your life, is your life and are your actions geared towards HaKadosh Baruch Hu all the time? Even if you listen, a person can go hiking and that could become, in a way, Avodat Hashem for him. And Chas v'Shalom, a person can learn Torah and that could be not Avodat Hashem. It all depends on your intent and the direction in which you're leading to. And it says, Rabbi Yehuda ya yoshev lifnei Rabbi Shimon. Rabbi Yehuda used to sit in front of Rabbi Shimon, and he used to read this pasuk, Kol tzofayich nas'u kol yachdav yeranenu. Kol tzofayich, the voice of those who contemplate on you. Litzpot is to contemplate, to look upon. Who are those called tzofayich? Elu em ha-metzapim. These are those who metzapim. Tzofayich mishum letzapot. Litzpot. I'm waiting for something to happen, like a scout, right? How do we call Har HaTzofim in English? Har HaTzofim is a mountain, right? If this is the Temple Mount, looking east, Har HaTzofim is here, Har HaZeitim is here, Mount Olives is here, Har HaTzofim. How do we call Har HaTzofim? Mount Scopes. Scope, Shum, telescope, to look. Tzofe. But Tzofe is not only that. Tzofe, the same root, is also similar to Metzape. Metzape, I'm expecting. So when I'm looking for something, you know, if I'm a scout and I'm looking, I'm looking for something to happen so I could report, right? So who are those hametzapim? So it's a very interesting, you need to look for something, and but you actually need to be looking. So who are those hametzapim? Those who are waiting when HaKadosh Baruch Hu Yerachem is going to have mercy and is going to allow us to build his house. Nas'u kol, what does it mean nas'u kol? They came up with a voice, Isu kol. You should have said Yisu, Yisu. They're going to uplift the voice, so they create. Nas'u means they carry it over. Mother mean Nas'u. Ma'u Nas'u kol, ela kol adam ha-boche. And a person who cries and lifts his voice on the destruction of Bet HaMikdash, zoche lema shekatuv achar kach. Then he's going to be merited with what it says after. Only those who are waiting, only those who feel the pain constantly, yachdav yeranenu, together they're going to rejoice. Well, why is that? It's very simple. If you go about your life, Bet HaMikdash, you know, right now I got survival ahead of me, you know, I gotta pay the bills. Even if Bet HaMikdash will be rejoiced, it's gonna be built, you're not going to rejoice in it. Maybe for a while, say, oh wow, that's interesting. All right, let me, 1 second, I got a text, let me just go back to this. There's no excitement, there's no anticipation of something happening. You are so involved with everything that you do. Even if Bet HaMikdash will be built, you go there one time to see, like out of curiosity, and you come back here to your life, and like nothing ever happened. And that's what I keep trying to explain to you all the time, in order to make you understand that there's certain emotions that you need to bring about you. If something happens to a Jew in France, you should feel the pain as it happened next door to you. Not out of paranoia, out of pain. You should be able to become sensitive to the pain of others. If you will be able to, or will do the emotion. And you know what? That has nothing to do only with pain. It has to do also with rejoicing, with simcha, with fun. Why? Because you go to a wedding, do you really feel the joy of the people in that having the simcha? Usually who is happy? The father and the mother of the kala, or the chatan, or they're probably busy how they're going to pay the bills, or who is happy? If sometimes nobody's happy. Everybody is just going to pay the bills. The chatan and kala are thinking how they're going to pay the bills. Everybody's about the bills. Why we have to have this wedding all together? Go have a barbecue and the thing, everybody will be happy. But when we go to a wedding, do we really feel the joy? We really feel the simcha? Do we really see HaKadosh Baruch Hu's hand in that? We go chas v'shalom to a funeral or to comfort mourners. Do we really feel the pain, their loss? Oh, we're just going there to pay lip service. When you go to Yerushalayim, do you ever feel the pain? Did you ever rip your shirt when you saw the kotel? Yeah, you say, oh, look at this, how beautiful everything is here. Oh, gorgeous. Honey, can you take a picture? Let me take a picture. You take a picture with the musk there that is right there like a pimple in the middle of your forehead. You need to go to the kotel and rip your clothes the first time you see it. People there are busy taking pictures. It's just ridiculous, by the way, with the pictures. And now with the telephones, even more ridiculous. Everything happens. Everybody takes pictures. You know, look at a wedding. Why are you taking pictures? Everything, taking pictures. Pictures. Everybody's taking pictures. Everybody became Ansel Adams all of a sudden, taking photography. The quality of pictures is horrendous. I mean, the cameras are terrific, but the quality is not there because you don't have any substance. So what substance would you have when they built Bet HaMikdash if you never cried for it, if you never felt the pain? How do you feel that, you know, you have foreigners sitting in your holiest place and they demand that it's theirs? You know, where are you? You don't feel connected to it because you're sitting here in America, or sitting in South Africa, or sitting in Australia, or in Canada, or whatever in the world you're sitting. I said, well, you might be even sitting in Israel and you don't feel anything. It's like, yeah, I'm here. There's no difference to me from sitting in Tel Aviv or I'm sitting in Jerusalem or sitting in Bangkok. It's all the same. Bnei Brak, Bangkok, all the same thing. Tel Aviv, Thailand, Eilat, Australia, all the same. It's all the same. I'm making a living. That's why people pick the stuff and they go. There's no connection. There's no emotional content. Right, Sam? What? Emotional content, that's right. Don't look at the finger, because you miss all this heaven and glory, right? It's like a finger pointed up to the sky. He says, so therefore, Yeranenu, v'zocheh li'irotu b'yishuv u'besimcha. Then you would merit, because of your caring. So you see, you had emotions. Because of that, because you felt the pain, you would merit to see, you were worthy to see. To see what? To see the Beit HaMikdash established and enjoy. How? B'shuv Hashem et Zion. B'shuv Hashem el Zion ayat tzarich. What does it need to say? Because it says, B'shuv Hashem, right? Zion. So you could should have said, when HaKadosh Baruch Hu would return to Zion. Not when HaKadosh Baruch Hu returned Zion. B'shuv Hashem et Zion, right? Et the, right? Instead of, it should say, B'shuv Hashem, where HaKadosh Baruch Hu will return to Zion, not the Zion. It says, come and see, when Yerushalayim was destroyed, when Yerushalayim down here, the Knesset Yisrael ugleta, when this entity of Knesset Yisrael was set to exile, and that's what we were learning yesterday in the Gemara in Kiddushin, the whole concept of Knesset Yisrael, Sanhedrin, and what else does it represent. Allah HaMelech HaKadosh LeZion, Kadosh Baruch Hu went up to Zion, v'ne'enach kenegda, and he sighed against her. Why? Because of Knesset Yisrael hugleta. When Knesset Yisrael went to exile, and now when Knesset Yisrael went to exile, HaKadosh Baruch Hu in a way embraced it and brought it closer to him, so it won't get completely lost. U'keshetachzor, Knesset Yisrael going to return to its place, then the king, the holy king, will return to Zion, to his place, to unify again with Am Yisrael. So in a way, when we went to Galut, there's a certain disconnect, a certain, not all, not a complete, a certain disconnect. It's like we are still connected, but teared a little bit. V'zehu shekatuv b'shuv Hashem Zion. V'az atidim Yisrael lomar. Then, when this will happen, Bnei Yisrael, the Jews would say, Ze Eli ve'anvehu, this is my God, and I will be humble because of him. V'katuv, Hashem kivinu lo nagila v'nismecha b'yeshuato. This is Hashem of which we were waiting, and we should rejoice in his redemption. And this is can only be done with love. Even when you are far away. Like a wife that the husband went away on a long journey across the ocean. We lost this today because we have Skype and WhatsApp, I don't know, whatever we got there today. So we don't feel that. We don't feel that longing. So that mimele, we don't develop that love because I can see the person across the ocean. But when a person goes out for a long journey, the wife needs to stay loyal to her husband. She's longing to see him. Like in the movies, you know, the guy is coming back from the war. You never seen people who go to war and how people welcome them when they come back to war, where they're weary from the battle and dust and dirty and wives and mothers wait in the windows just to see if the sun is coming, and God forbid to see the army car coming with officers to tell her that something had happened. You don't know this anticipation. You never felt this tear inside of you, because it just doesn't happen. Since you never felt it, how could you ever feel love? It doesn't make a difference if before the war you were fighting, there was a war amongst you, and all of a sudden you're gone, and you feel that you want to be back home, and she wants you back home. And with all the dust, and you didn't put the deodorant for like 5 days, and you stink, and you smell, and then grease on you, and blood on you, and who knows what else is on you. It's like the smell of heaven when you come back together. We separated ourselves in a way deliberately from HaKadosh Baruch Hu for 2,000 years. And only love will bring us back together. Only love. When we say, Ve'ahavta le'reacha kamocha, well, you should love your fellow Jew. Love. The other place that we are commanded to love is to love Hashem. Ve'ahavta et Hashem Elokecha b'chol levavcha, right? If you don't feel that love to your fellow Jew, don't tell me you feel love to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And if you say that you feel love to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, how can you love your fellow Jew? Knesset Yisrael and HaKadosh Baruch Hu Chadhu is one thing. It's like you say, I love my wife's right hand, right side, but left side, I go, I can't stand it. It's impossible. So that's why you need to develop your love. You want to go back to Am Yisrael, you want to show HaKadosh Baruch Hu that you really love him, don't put yourself signs of jealousy. Oh, I love HaKadosh Baruch Hu, take a t-shirt, I love God, you know? Don't do that. Show it by action. Start loving your fellow Jews. Start taking care of those who are not as fortunate as you. Start bring love into their life. Being zealous to HaKadosh Baruch Hu does not mean always taking a spear and sticking it into people. Being zealous to HaKadosh Baruch Hu means sacrificing from yourself for the sake of others because you love them, not because you have to. When you put tefillin on, you do it because you want to, not because you have to. And if you love to do so, it cannot be a day that you're not going to be putting tefillin on. That it will never happen. Or there won't be a day in which you don't pray. Because you don't have to pray. You want to pray. And Shabbat will not be an issue for you. You will look forward to Shabbat because you don't have to keep Shabbat. Because you want to keep Shabbat. Because Shabbat symbolizes something to you. And when you go to Israel, it's not about taking pictures and putting on your status on Facebook. When you go to Yerushalayim, it's to see the people, to see the land, to smell it, to kiss it. So the smell of the land will saturate into your DNA. So before you go to Bangkok or before you go to the Dominican Republic, go to Israel. Go to Israel, speak to the people, go to the market, make a bracha on fruit that grows in Israel. That's what we're talking about, love. It takes a totally different aspect, a totally different mahalach, point of view, outlook when you do things with love rather than fear, then because you have to. You don't give tzedakah to the Jew because you have to, because you want to. It's a totally different attitude. It's a totally different attitude. And during this time, especially now, this 3 weeks before we go into Tisha B'Av, everybody cannot wait to get out of Tisha B'Av. Okay, Baruch Hashem, we finished with this. All right, let's go celebrate. Let's do parties. Let's go back into this thing. Why? What's the problem? You don't want to mourn it, so you don't want to rejoice it. Don't tell me that. How are you going to make pilgrimage to Eretz Israel if you want to get over things now? How are you going to wait for Mashiach, right? And to have Olam Shekulo Shabbat if you cannot celebrate 2 days of Chag in Chutz La'aretz? I don't understand you. Why do we have to wait 2 days? Why not? Why do you care? You eat, you make brachot. What's so bad about having 2 days of Kedusha? What's the big deal? I mean, for me, it's different. I was born in Israel. To keep 2 days is like a new thing. I said, this is terrific. It's wonderful. 2 days of Chag. Wonderful, wonderful. What's so bad about it? To have 3 day Chag, everybody, oh my, this was so difficult. It's a 3 day Chag. What's so bad? 3 days Chag, terrific. First day of Chag, second day of Chag, and Shabbat. Doesn't get any better. Can I get another one? Terrific. There's the attitude. The attitude is because you have to. You're afraid of being burned in hell and whatever it is. Okay, you know what? That's how things look like. The first chance you have, you're taking a detour and you end up doing something else. And that's the difference between people who come to yeshiva because they want to, or because people who come to yeshiva because they have to, or they just accidentally dropped in like a leaf in the wind. Rabotai, remember this. And start loving HaKadosh Baruch Hu. If you want to love your family, you want to love anybody in your life, the easiest thing to do is to love HaKadosh Baruch Hu because it does so much for us. And love, the first stage of love will be appreciation. So look carefully what God is doing for you. How wonderful He is. How much brachot does He give each and every one of us. Look at what you have. Don't look at what you don't have. Appreciate what you have and then love God. Shabbat Shalom.